Okay, good afternoon, everybody. My name is Will Schulders from Technische Universiteit Eindhoven, and it's my pleasure to introduce the speaker of the Felix Klein Prize Lecture, Arnulf Jensen. Arnulf Jensen is a full professor in the Faculty of Mathematics and Computer Science at the University of Münster, and also a member of the German Excellence Cluster Mathematics Münster at the University of Münster. The core research of Professor Jensen is topics in machine learning, approximation algorithms, computational stochastics, numerical analysis for high-dimensional partial differential equations, stochastic analysis, and computational finance. He's a well-known expert for numerical schemes on stochastic differential equations. In recent years, he has been one of the driving forces promoting the use of deep learning methods to approximate solutions of partial differential equations and related problems. His work is also relevant for the numerical treatment of popular models in financial mathematics. And the significance of his research at the time of his nomination was impressively underlined by 797 citations on MathSciNet at an age of 35 years. So, Professor Jensen, the floor is yours.
Yeah, many thanks for the introduction. And let me also say that I feel really extremely honored to have been selected for the Felix Klein Prize. And yeah, it's a great pleasure and a great honor for me to also to deliver this lecture now. So let me share my screen.
Yeah, let me just add that if people have questions, they can put them in the Q&A or in the chat. And if they're urgent, I will try to interrupt the speaker.
Very good. Okay, so the talk is about overcoming the curse of dimensionality from nonlinear Monte Carlo to deep learning. And so in many relevant problems, one is interested to approximate a high dimensional function, say a function u from say some d dimensional cube to the reals, where here a and b are two real numbers with a smaller than b, and d a natural number where d is large, where large starts something like d greater or equal than 3 or 4, going up to 10 dimensions or 100 or thousands of space dimensions. And such computational problems to approximatively compute such functions is particularly relevant in pricing problems in financial engineering, but also in optimal control problems, and many other relevant situations where often such high dimensional functions appear as solutions of PDEs. And standard approximation methods from the scientific literature for approximating, for solving PDEs or for solving such problems, they suffer under the so-called like standard approximation methods, like finite difference approximation or finite elements approximations. They suffer under the so-called curse of dimensionality, in the sense that the number of computational operations or the number of real numbers in the approximation scheme grows exponentially in the problem dimension. And recently, a new class somehow or recently deep learning based approximation schemes for such problems for PDEs have been proposed. And numerical simulations indicate that such deep learning based numerical approximation schemes do overcome the curse of dimensionality, in the sense that they only need a polynomial number of parameters in the dimension. And there are many so of such deep learning based schemes. They basically consist of employing deep neural networks in the approximation algorithm and stochastic or deterministic gradient descent type optimization schemes. And there are many numerical simulation results for in the literature now where such deep learning schemes have been applied to high dimensional approximation problems. But there are only a few theoretical results. And until today, there's no full theoretical explanation why such schemes might overcome the curse of dimensionality. But there are at least now a result which explains, or results which explain, that deep neural network have the fundamental power to overcome the curse of dimensionality in such problems. And the first of the two slides which I want to present you in this talk is about the first result, which shows in the context of certain semilinear PDEs or nonlinear PDEs that deep neural networks can overcome the curse of dimensionality in the approximation of such PDEs. Let me now come to the precise result. So we consider a semilinear PDE on a time interval where here this big T plays the role of the time horizon. The big T is a real number bigger than zero, describing the time horizon. And then we want to measure the error between the solution of the PDE and the neural network in the LP sense. And this real number P here, bigger than zero, is used to express this LP error. And then we also need some regularity assumptions on the solution of the PDE. And this is formulated here by means of this real number kappa. Okay, so as I said, so we consider semilinear, or if you want semilinear PDEs or semilinear heat PDEs, and the nonlinearity in the PDE will be denoted by this Lipschitz continuous function f here. And now when one wants to make a statement about the curse of dimensionality, about how the number of parameters in the network, or how the amount of memory needed to store the network grows in the dimension, then one cannot just fix the dimension and consider one specific PDE, say in 20 space dimensions. But instead, one need to consider a whole sequence, a whole family of PDEs indexed over the dimension. And each of these PDEs has an initial condition. And this here, this function GD, which is assumed to be a continuously differentiable function from the RD to the reals. And then corresponding to each initial condition, we have a solution function of the PDE UD here from the interval 0t times the RD to the reals, and satisfies this semilinear heat equation, where here is a second order operator, the Laplacian, here the nonlinearity, and here the initial condition of the PDE. And now when we want to, so that's the equation we want to solve, that's the functions we want to approximate by means of deep neural networks. And we want to do this without the curse of dimensionality. And to have a chance to accomplish this, we need that this function itself somehow, roughly speaking, grow at most polynomially in the problem dimension, in the dimension D. And for this, we assume here some regularity on the initial condition, that the initial condition and the derivative of the initial condition, the gradient, grow at most polynomially. Both here or in the dimension and also in the space variable. And now we want to formulate neural networks to approximate this solution, the solutions of these PDEs here. And yeah, to formulate neural networks, so what we can think of as neural network, let us give a precise mathematical description of a neural network. So roughly speaking, you can think of the neural network as a function, okay, which consists of multiple compositions of first an affine linear function, and then so affine linear function with a matrix and a vector, and then a one specific or nonlinear function, and then again an affine linear function, then again the same nonlinear function, then again an affine linear function, then again the same nonlinear function, and then at the end again once more an affine linear function. And there are many of such compositions, and basically how many of such composition one has, how many affine linear functions, that describe the deepness of the network. So now, okay, we need to formulate now mathematically some affine linear functions and nonlinear functions. And the nonlinear functions we employ are so-called rectifier functions. So these are these functions AL, they called A because often these nonlinear functions are called activation functions in the context of neural networks. And they map from the RL to the RL for any natural number L. And they are defined, these rectifier function. So AL of some vector x1, x2, xl is nothing else but maximum of x1 and 0 in the first component, maximum of x2 and 0 in the second component, maximum of x3 and 0 in the third component, and so on, and maximum of xl and 0 in the last component. And that are these nonlinear functions which we employ in the neural network description. And these somehow there are also different nonlinear functions which one could employ, but this is basically the most, roughly speaking, I think the most popular, the most frequently employed activation function, the most frequently employed nonlinear function in the neural network function. Okay, and now we need to describe the affine linear transformations in between the nonlinear functions. And that is done using this set curly N here, which is a structured set of tuples of real numbers. So here's a union over all natural number L and union over all L0, L1, LL. And then we consider here a Cartesian product. So L tuples, we consider here L tuples of matrix vector pairs. So this here is a set of all LN times LN minus one matrices. And this here is a set of all LN dimensional vectors. And this Cartesian product here is a set of all pairs consisting in the first component of one LN times LN minus one dimensional matrix, and here one LN dimensional vector. Okay, so this here describes one affine linear transformation. And this here, this set of L tuples of such matrix vector pairs describes L affine linear transformation. And so basically you can think of this set as a set of all neural networks. And now to each element of such a set, for instance, phi equal to this 1 1 0 0 0 0 comma 0 0 1 1. So this is one simple example of an element in the set old phase N, in which case we have that L is equal to 2, because we have here a pair, a two tuple. Okay, so I'll use a different color here to express the outer tuple. And then inside we have here two matrix vector pairs. So this is the first matrix vector pair. This is the second matrix vector pair. And in this case here, so L would be 2 and L0, L1, L2 would all be equal to 2, because this here somehow, yeah, is a 2 times 2 matrix, and this is also a 2 times 2 matrix. And now to each element phi in this set boldface N, we assign now a function, and this is done by means of this function R here. So this realization function, that's why it's called R, which takes an element, such a tuple, such a structured tuple of real numbers, and assigns to it a continuous function from the R to the power of A to the R to the power of B, where A and B are here arbitrary natural numbers, in the sense that for all natural numbers L, so for all the number of all, of all L tuples or number of affine linear transformations, and all dimensions in between of these affine linear transformations L0, L1, LL, and all matrix vector tuples of matrix vector pairs. So this is the first matrix vector pair. This describes the first affine linear transformation, and this is the last affine linear transformation, and this is an L tuple. This here is a matrix, this is a vector, and this is one matrix vector pair. This is one, the last matrix vector pair. And for all x0 in the RL0 and x1 in the IL1 and xl in the IL, with the property that these xn are given recursively through xn is here the nonlinear function, okay, here, which we have defined before, the multidimensional rectifier function applied to the affine linear transformation given through the nth component of this L tuple here, Wn applied to xn minus 1 bn. So that's how these xn here are defined recursively. So basically x0 is arbitrary, but x1 and x2 and so on, they are all defined through xn. And then we define our phi of x0 is wl xl minus 1 plus bl. Okay, so this is this standard framework in the literature, how one can describe artificial neural networks. So this is a set of all artificial neural network. And this function here assigns to each such a neural network a function from a continuous function from the RA to the RB.
Arnulf, there is a question whether this A is equal to L0 and B is equal to LL. Is that true?
Yeah, in this specific this definition, exactly, we have that A is equal to L0 and B is equal to LL, exactly. And here, of course, we quantify, so that's why the codomain of the mapping need to have here a union over all a, b, one infinity, but exactly as you said, a is equal to L0 and b is equal to LL. And then, okay, this is now how we specify the function to each neural network. And then we also need to measure how much memory is needed for such a neural network on a computer. And this is done through this function p here, which counts the number of parameters of the network. So for instance, in this specific example here, where we have like a two tuple, okay, consisting maybe in the first matrix vector pair here of 1, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1. So that's the first matrix vector pair. Then we have a comma, and the second one is now 1, 1, 0. Okay, so in this example, big L would be again 2. And L0 would be 2, L1 would be 2, because this here is a 2 times 2 matrix. But now L2 would be equal to 1, because this is a 2 times 1 matrix. And then the formula, okay, so for this number of parameters, P phi, is the sum from K running from 1 to L, it then LK multiplied by LK minus 1 plus 1. Okay, so this is not, or I can also write it this way, the sum from K1 to L, then LK multiplied with LK minus 1 plus LK. So this here are all real numbers needed to describe the matrix. And this here are all real numbers needed to describe the vector. And then we discount all of these real numbers and for all affine linear transformation. So for instance, in this simple example, we have P phi equal to, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So in this example, the number of parameters would be 9. We use exactly 9 real numbers to describe this element here, this in the set boldface N, to describe this neural network. And so you can see here, if you calculate here L1, 2 multiplied with 2 plus 1, so it's 3. So 2 multiplied by 3 is 6, plus 1 multiplied with 2 plus 1 plus multiplied by 3. So as you have 6 plus 3 is indeed 9. So 6 for this affine linear transformation and 3 real numbers for the second affine linear transformation, resulting overall to 9 real numbers to describe the whole neural network in this very simple example here. And now the assumption we put on this problem is that the initial conditions of the PDE, they can be approximated by possibly deep neural networks without the curse of dimensionality. More formally, we assume that there exists such networks here, a family of elements in boldface N, in this set boldface N, so indexed over the problem dimension and the approximation precision epsilon, in the sense that the number of parameters grow at most polynomially in the dimension and in the inverse of the precision, and in the sense that the error between the exact solution of between the initial condition and the function, the realization of the neural network, is smaller or equal than epsilon multiplied by kappa multiplied by d to the power of kappa multiplied by 1 plus the norm of x to the power of kappa. So in particular, you can see we assume here the existence of networks in a way so that for fixed x and for fixed d, if epsilon converges to zero, then this function here, the realization of this network, the realization function of this network evaluated at x converges to the initial condition of the PDE evaluated at x. Okay, so basically this assumption tells us that there exist neural networks which converge to these initial conditions of the PDE, which approximate this initial condition of the PDE, where the number of parameters for these networks, where the amount of memory for these networks needed to store on a computer grows at most polynomially in the problem dimension and the inverse of the precision. And under this assumption, now we have that if this initial condition can be approximated by neural networks, then we have as a conclusion that there exist also neural networks here, a family of neural networks indexed over the problem dimension and the precision, and a constant C, such that for all dimension D and for every precision, we have that the error between the exact solution of the PDE and the realization of the network measured in the LP sense, this error, or the amount of memory, the amount of parameters for these neural networks to achieve such a precision, to achieve an error of size epsilon, this grows at most polynomially in both the problem dimension and the inverse of the prescribed approximation accuracy. Okay, so in that sense, this result shows that deep neural networks, that such class of approximators have the fundamental capacity to approximate solutions of these semilinear heat PDEs without the curse of dimensionality if the initial conditions can be approximated without the curse of dimensionality. And usually in applications, okay, like Hamilton-Jacobi-Bellman PDEs or pricing problems from financial engineering, then the initial conditions are given concrete. They are like, for example, consists of some logarithm or some maximum or affine linear transformation. And then one can usually, often many situations easily verify that the initial condition can be approximated without the curse of dimensionality. Then at the conclusion that we know that also the whole solution can be approximated without the curse of dimensionality. And
So Arnold, there are some questions here on this slide. So one of them is, does the approximation from the neural network solve the original PDE? Probably not, but.
The approximation is of course, this error is not zero. So this approximation does not exactly solve the solution of the PDE, but that's the same like in finite difference or finite element approximation, right? One is usually already happy if one has a function which is close to the unique function which solves the actually PDE. If it would solve the PDE, it would coincide actually with the solution of the PDE.
Yeah, and the other question is there a result saying when such a G of D epsilon exists?
Yeah, there are several of such results which give sufficient condition for the existence of these networks. And basically, for instance, as I said, like some, if you take some smooth function and then combine it with some one-dimensional smooth function or low-dimensional smooth function, combine it with affine linear transformation or maxima, something like this, or simple products, then such networks exist. But there are also results which show that there are also counterexamples of such functions, that there are certain functions which cannot be approximated like within a class of networks with only a polynomial number of parameters. Okay, so as I said, in applications, usually initial condition is given, and then it's usually no big difficulty to verify the existence of such networks. Okay, so, or you can, for example, take of as GD of X, for example, one example where it's satisfied is take the norm of X squared, or also some GD of X taking some sine or cosine or any smooth function of the norm of X, or something like sine of some scalar product sine X with some vectors VD, something like this. These are all functions or for which this condition here is satisfied. And okay, so this result, okay, is the first somehow basically only result for non-PDEs involving non-linearities, but before there were some results of this kind for linear PDEs. And let me now comment, okay, this is a pure existence result, okay, so asserting the existence of neural networks which can approximate the solution of these PDEs without the curve of dimensionality, but doesn't say something, I mean, how to actually to get such an approximation. And there are two procedures available. One is basically a completely different algorithm called multi-level Picard, by which one can somehow have some random procedure how to calculate the weights and the biases, and which then, for which is also then proved that this algorithm can approximate the solution without the curve of dimensionality. But in the context of machine learning and supervised learning problems, usually a different procedure is used. And that is that one somehow considers basically some kind of risk function, which is basically, roughly speaking, the difference of the solution of the PDE and the neural networks. And now with P equal to 2, so you can think of this as a risk function. And then one computes, or one, let's starts with some random bad approximation, and then one improves the approximation by computing gradients with respect to that risk function, and then trying to minimize that function by following the negative gradient. And such schemes, so gradient descent approximation schemes or gradient flows, and yeah, for them they are only partial, quite even so they are quite promising mathematical analysis approaches for such gradient flows or gradient descent optimization schemes. In the literature there are still only a limited understanding. And now I want to give you one more slide about a few results in this direction, about the training procedure, about the convergence, I mean, how one can actually compute such neural networks that minimize, that intend to minimize this kind of risk, such risk functions. And to do so, we now restrict ourselves to the specific situation where L is equal to 2, where there are only two affine linear transformations in the network. And so more formally, so here D is again the dimension of the function which we want to approximate. So here now U is a function from A, B to D to the reals, A, B to D to the reals. So this function, which is not necessarily a solution of a PDE anymore, but which maps from this D-dimensional cube. And now H is plays the role. So L0 is equal to D in the context of the previous slide, and L1, somehow the dimension after the first affine linear transformation is here, this plays the role of this number H, this the number, the dimension in the hidden layer. So that's why it's called H here. And now P, these parameters from the previous slide. So here L2 is equal to 1. So then this P is equal to L2 multiplied by L1 plus 1 plus L1 multiplied by L0 plus 1 is then equal to, so 1 multiplied by H plus 1 plus H multiplied by D plus 1, giving overall, so H plus 1 plus HD plus H is equal to HD plus 2H plus 1. Okay, so that will be the value of this natural number P. So let's make this a bit more formal. Okay, so here D, H, and P are natural numbers. and A and B are two real numbers with B bigger than A, and U here is a continuous function, that's our target function, which we want to approximate from the d-dimensional cube here, AB to the power of D to the reals. And P here is, as I said, this DH plus 2H plus 1 is a number of parameters of the network. And in the previous slide, U was a solution of a PDE, which we want to approximate, but here now U can be an arbitrary continuous function. And then, okay, to formulate the risk function, we use here a finite measure, mu, okay, which somehow in the context of supervised learning problems in machine learning, this would be a probability measure. And this probability measure would be the distribution of the input data of the considered supervised learning problem. And now with that measure in mind, we can now formulate the risk function, which I've sketched on the previous slide. And this is here denoted by this function L from this R to the power of network parameters to the reals, which satisfies for all vectors theta in the R to the power of P with components, with the components of theta being theta one, theta two, and so on, theta P. This risk function here, given as L of theta, is the integral between here the exact solution or the target function. So in the previous context of the previous slide, the solution of the PDE, and here minus the realization of the neural network. And that's what has here been in the case in the simple situation where L is equal to two, where just two affine linear transformation, we can just write it out. So here is the first affine linear transformation. Then here's the rectifier activation function. And then this here is the second affine linear transformation, the inhomogeneity, the linear part. And then we subtract this from the target function here, possibly a solution of a PDE, and integrate with respect to the measure mu. And then now the idea of these gradient flows or gradient descent type optimization algorithms is now to evolve according to the negative gradient of this function L here. But this function L is in general is not differentiable for every theta because this is a not smooth function. It's like almost this maximum comma zero is not everywhere differentiable. It's not differentiable at zero because I mean this function looks like this, and here at zero it's not differentiable. But then one can employ basically the left derivative of this function, giving here always zero and here then one and here including zero as well. And so basically we use here the gradient of that object we denoted by G, the generalized, appropriately generalized gradient, which is basically given through by employing the left derivative here of this maximum function. So this is this G here. So this risk function maps from the number of real numbers, the parameter space describing the neural networks. So this here is the number of real numbers needed to store the network on a computer. And so each vector describes the neural network, and this maps here from this parameter space of the neural networks to the reals, and the gradient, of course, maps then from the R to P from the parameter space to the parameter space. And then now we consider such a gradient flow or gradient descent optimization method. So we take a continuous function theta, which starts at some theta zero, and then evolves according to the negative gradient of that risk function L here. Okay, so theta T is equal to theta zero minus the integral from zero to t, g of theta s ds. And in concrete implementations of machine learning algorithms, usually one takes usually like a stochastic gradient descent optimization method or deterministic, but usually stochastic gradient descent optimization method. But somehow this stochastic gradient descent optimization method can be considered as discretizations of this ordinary differential equation, of discretization of the flow of this ordinary differential equation. And so in view of this, we now, or many other, also study now such differential equations. And now I want to present you three somehow convergence results for such gradient flows, and some of these results do not only apply to such gradient flows, but also to gradient descent, to stochastic gradient descent optimization methods, which are the ones which are actually used in concrete implementations. Okay, so the first result applies in the very simplified situation where this u function here is a constant function. Okay, so if this u is a constant function, then so the difficulty why somehow standard results from optimization cannot be brought into play here is because this is not convex and it has usually many non-global local minima and also many saddle points. But in the specific situation where this function u here is a constant function, this function is still not convex, but then there exists no non-global local minima and also no saddle points of the risk function. And as a consequence, in that case, one has that the risk of the gradient flow trajectory converges to zero. So if this quantity here converges to zero, then this realization of this neural network or this realization of this neural network here converges in the L2 sense to the target function. Okay, so that's what we want. So if this here converges to zero. Now, so that was in this specific situation where the target function is constant. So in that case, the problem is still not convex, but every critical point is a global minima. Okay, so and then it's not so challenging anymore to verify this statement here, the convergence of the risk to zero. And now we come to the more challenging situation where the target function is assumed to be an affine function, or more formally, so assume that this measure here is just the Lebesgue-Borel measure on the interval AB, and assume that the target function is an affine linear function. So u of x for all x in the interval AB, so this is also the one-dimensional situation here, coincide with alpha x plus beta. And then in this situation, we have classified all critical points. We have all classified all zeros basically of this generalized gradient. And there it turns out, so that in this situation, there are infinitely many non-global local minima and also infinitely many saddle points of the risk function. But nonetheless, we have verified convergence of the risk to zero as soon as the gradient flow trajectory is assumed to be bounded and as soon as the initial risk is not too high. Okay, so not too high meaning here in this affine linear situation that this initial risk is smaller than this quotient here. So there you see the difference of the interval length b minus a to the power of 3, and this affine, this linear part here squared divided by 12 multiplied by 2 h over 2 round down. So the largest natural number smaller or equal than h over 2 plus 1 to the power of 4. And then one has here a convergence to zero. And why is this specific bound here? Because in this work here, we have shown that somehow, so H here is the number of neurons on the hidden layer, okay, is the dimension after the first affine linear transformation. And in this work here, we have verified that if the risk is smaller than this value here, then all critical points are global minima. And the saddle points and the non-global local minima, they are all have a risk larger than this value here. Okay, so that's for this affine linear case. And for the general case, the last statement there, if we assume that this measure here is absolutely continuous with respect to the Lebesgue-Borel measure. And if the gradient flow trajectory is bounded, then we cannot assert anymore, or it does not hold anymore convergence of the risk to zero, but at least it converges to the risk of some vector theta, var theta, and this vector is a critical point. So it's a zero of this generalized gradient. So in the general case, we know at least that the risk must converge to the risk of a critical point. And with this last comment, I would like to close the talk and thank you for your attention.